beyond informal mechanisms, what formal mechanisms and institutions would ensure the enactment of cosmopolitan citizenship. We have also seen, to an extent perhaps had not been seen in the classical period of the European nation-state, various regional movements and movements toward devolution. Of course, in Britain, there has been considerable talk, at least in the last 700 years, anyway, about devolution, but particularly the last 10 years with the devolution of Scottish Parliament and the Welsh Parliament. And then what is the content of exactly the British citizenship? If there is a devolution of parliaments into decentralized forms of existence, what remains as the content of British citizenship? And of course, we see this ongoing struggles in various multinational states such as Canada, so much so that now scholars are even talking about multinational states. And so scales of citizenship have also proliferated and became much more complex. And then there are certain other category of things that we might call acts of citizenship that have emerged in the past 10 years, at least in a more articulate way. It's not that acts of citizenship did not exist before. Voting is an act of citizenship, and it is as classical as it gets in terms of enactment of citizenship in a democratic framework. So that's a classical example of act of citizenship. But then we have acts of civil disobedience being constituted as acts of citizenship. Some would argue, and I would argue against, acts of violence can constitute themselves as acts of citizenship. Some others have argued that acts such as flash mobs, I don't know if you know about them, these instantaneously organized through cell phones and email of acts where certain points made publicly by taking charge or taking hold of a certain public space and making it function differently. So there are various acts, and of course other classical example is a street demonstration and the valorization of the significance of demonstration on the streets as an act of citizenship that articulates something. So then it's a very complex terrain. Each of these strands in and of themselves are very complex terrains in which to do work, in which to do also work that has policy relevance, political relevance, as well as analytical vigor that really does justice to that complexity. Both panels have indicated that, if not more, but at least indicated how difficult it is, even amongst ourselves, we will struggle through certain terminologies. So each of which is immensely complex to operate in, particularly with what we call here at the Open University the constructivist sensibilities, that there's certain epistemological, ontological approach to things that don't take them for granted, that sees social and political processes behind them. Especially when you complexify things that way, each of these are quite complex indeed. But even more complex, what is it that connects them? What is the tissue that actually binds them together? What is it that we can use a particular idiom, a language that would just enable actually translate one to the other of certain things? What would that be in the sense that it would enable us sort of cross-translation? Now, before we talk about that, we still have to introduce one more complexity. What actually translates the three strands into one another? Before it is language, it is the humdrum, the complexity of everyday life, the domains of life, as it were. That's where actually these things get translated, although not perhaps in ways in which we would easily recognize or even like. These translations that happen on the ground with the languages that people use are shot through paradoxes, contradictions, inconsistencies, inarticulacies, if that's a word, elements that make it really difficult to just sort of analytically give vigor to them. That's the complexity of social life. In that social life, for simplifying it, various domains interact with one another and actually bring citizenship identities and governance into a dialogue with one another, that each term becomes absolutely essential for the other. These domains are, of course, domains of the political, that we can actually see that identities get articulated as political identities, which then get connected into issues of questions of governance, which then might get articulated as a question of citizenship. So then we might just see, for example, a transgender identity that in and of itself does not necessarily cross different strands, but then might become a question of governance. In other words, conduct of conduct in public space, space understood in both the material and the symbolic sense of that term. And then we could see in the cultural domain, in the cultural field, constantly identities being translated into governance, governance translated into citizenship, and borrowing idioms from one another and articulating themselves as certain things. And we see that in the cultural field. For example, the issue of it borders on the multicultural, but I really don't know why multicultural issues cannot be considered within the context of cultural. Having certain rights of broadcasting in a given nation state, in a polity, in a given language, for example. In the domain of art, how it gets articulated into the issue of governance, obviously broadcasting means that licensing, and then licensing, of course, then gets connected into the issue of citizenship. Well, do citizenships or can citizens do this? The question arises. And then we have other domains, the domain of the social, going to speed up, and domain of the legal, how it gets translated, and of course ecological, and in a way this is really artificial, the simplicity I'm introducing. There's really no limit to these domains and their articulations. It has to be decided what domains come into play with one another in a given question of identity as it relates to a question of government that in fact relates to citizenship. So it is intensely specific question as to what domains are articulated into one another to create these cross-translation, cross-dialogue activity. Now, I have been avoiding, and I don't know if you notice, once in a while I'll just kind of stop and pause and avoid using a particular word. And that's the word that I actually had in mind when we talked about the first panel and the second panel, the idea being missing and that the connecting tissue. That word, the connecting tissue, is actually first the issue of responsibilities. But responsibilities cannot be defined without rights. What I would like to propose to you today, and in the next few moments, hopefully make a convincing argument, that the connecting tissue amongst the three strands of the center, as well as in general when we talk about, is the question of articulation of rights. I know that there's saturation of the talk about rights. I know that there is also sort of dismay and dissatisfaction expressed at the rights talk as having gone too far. And I know that there is also enormous confusion right now as to what constitutes the difference between citizenship rights and human rights. These are complexities of the issue of rights. But just because these complexities have been introduced to the question of rights does not mean that we have to run away from it.